I'm a baby of the generation of the 60s and into the 70s, minimalism, primary structures, and so on. And in view and watching or studying those artists that I found to be extremely interesting, Carl Andre, Lever, Chad, of course, and people like that. And at the same time, considering the idea of abandoning the studio, leaving the studio, abandoning the studio is how we used to speak about it. And a small group of artists in the late 60s began to work outside the studio into what became working situ. Buren, Asher, Marcel Brodeur, people like that. And it dawned on me that there was fundamental problems in the work of the prior generation. Typically, a younger artist wanting to begin by taking on their elders. So in viewing the work, it seemed like the ideas that they had and the conversations that they shared about that they were site-specific projects didn't add up for me, didn't make sense. It was a flawed logic. Not just me, Danielle, Michael, I chose Andre because I thought he was a most complete and primary example of the better work, and at the same time, the more obvious problem. In fact, those pieces could be moved from place to place at any time. So I took Lever as an example of Andre's, and I chose to use Carpenter's levels as the joke, serious conceptual joke, to say, actually, my work is literally site-specific. It indexes the room. And although it can be moved from place to place, it's always literally specific to that place because it registers that levelness. This is something, the kind of thinking that that came to my mind, also based on my great admiration for Art de Pauvre, and the idea of using these kinds of, quote, impoverished tools or mediums, and there was a certain kind of conceptual lyricism in it. It wasn't so stiff and limited as the newer generation of conceptual artists, art language, English work, some New York work, things like that. It had more playfulness to it. And it was something that I always found to be much richer. So there's that element coming into play. That allowed me the ability to start to think about other kinds of tools or objects. So I did it in a studio that I had, the last studio I had, circles, lines, and things like that. And I never showed them, or I didn't show them for a very long time, actually in a formal exhibition situation. But I do consider the levels to be the kind of foundational beginning to what I would consider my work after student work and mimicking other work and things like that. I never used them again for many, many years. And I have to say, I did two quasi-retrospectives in 89 and 90, in Lyon and in Rotterdam. And in those, I reintroduced them, for the first time. They also have the relationship of difference between primary structures a la Smith, which I consider the historically most important work, Dye. That was really the work, and the rest of it's decorative work to me. That made the statement of the whole generation. And then on the other side, Andre. But Andre's was also a primary senior structure because they were connected. So my interest was to pull them apart and address the idea of working in series or a serial amount of pieces to one work. which is something that I've done time and again for 50 years now. There's always 50 plates or something like that. And they're always slightly different, but they have the same consideration of the form. So they're not a multiple, and yet they appear to be a multiple. That's a very important part of my practice, to never do multiples, but to address the idea of repetition. I do them in my catalogs too. Same operation was find a format, it works, and then every time just change the content in the interior. Move it around a little bit, you know. I have chosen to show them here because I felt there was something about Japanese cultural history, Japanese aesthetics, and geophysical issues that Los Angeles shares with Japan. Always moving, always, so there. It's like it would be a primary tool, one of the primary tools of registering the real actions of a place. At the same time, I think that it allowed me to take some positions or cultural, philosophical, or ideological moments from architecture. I personally, architecture and sculpture, space and time, and bring them into the project. One is Ma space, which is one of the reasons why I separated the pieces, because I had studied Japanese philosophy and architecture many years ago. And the idea of it's not the object, but it's the space in between was always extremely interesting for me as a concept, as a global philosophical concept, in relation to Western thinking. Object is always a precious commodity. And the space in between is discard. And the other one is the architectural elements of paint or paint in plaster that you see sacred architecture in Japan and in architecture of merchants and machia architecture of the 17th and 19th century. The idea of paint coat down to a point and then normally below a wood wainscoting. I wanted to be able to also operate like advertising and branding. So it has the relative scaling one to the other. I think it may be a little bit off. It should be less paint further up. And then it also is, I picked color because it conflated the colors used in Shinto shrines and other architecture in interior paper and things. And also, by chance or not, it's exactly the color that brands the CCA. So I have branded my work or connected my work to you in that way. So it's in situ in that way. And with the sign, I wanted to utilize it like I've used signs many, many times before, to use something sacred in a manner of speaking or not, but then fill it with pop content or advertising strategies of infill graphics, which has always been a fascination of mine. And in this case, the idea is to say there's nothing precious. Even characters or terms or words in other languages that are very important and fundamentally globally philosophical, you'll find on the sign in a vitrine of a window of a pharmacy. There's no mercy on any of this. It's all part of the commercial gamut. Right? Mm-hmm. So here's something which is like a travel poster inside this character. And so that construction of desire function. And I always choose those kinds of images because you have to love them because they're always beautiful or seductive. It's just exactly like Madison Avenue and advertising works. Construct desire and then sell a product. And that's super perverse. And yet at the same time, we all engage with it. All my pieces are like that. I try to make them that way. And that also comes back to Art de Pauvre. Because when you read Art de Pauvre, it's extremely elegant. Even if it's steel and pipes and things, there's something very elegant about it. Maybe it's just the consciousness of Italian expression. But, you know, simple texts like Anselmo, the projections onto someone in midair, particulari, white text, and you don't see it until someone walks across a room and it hits them on their pant leg. This is so beautiful and so elegant, and you know, those kind of things have been hugely important to me. I may never use them again. I used them, as you know, 2 years ago in Minster, but in that case I used one, and it doesn't actually function. The bubble is made out of very, very beautifully crafted out of loose like plastic, and then it's computer cut. And the point was that it's not registered. It registers a building because people know that's what it does. But my interest was to make a building sign. This brings in my great interest and the great influence of people like Robert Venturi, Denise Scott Brown, Charles Moore, people like that have had on my practice. It's this thing that's like a pharmacy sign or a bar or a restaurant. In this case, it's a sign of Munster Sculpture Project. Mm. It's a real sign, semiologically, and a building sign. Mm. Okay. I probably will never do it again, or maybe I will. Mm. You know, my feeling is that work can be done, not again. Mm. But this work I consider this work to be a new work in situ. If it were done somewhere else, it would be a new work in situ. Because the conditions are different.
Yes.
You know, and maybe, you know. Yeah. But I conflated the three elements together. And for me, it's a bit difficult to work with galleries, because I'm so used to working, you know, and I'm not particularly in love with the notion of a gallery, you know. But here we are.
You know, here Thank it you. Is, yeah.
Well, this is a huge conversation that people have all the time. And when I started working, it was a much smaller world. Mm-hmm. It was really a kind of a subculture. Although there was a whole history of art, you could live in one little neighborhood in New York or Los Angeles, and that would be where everybody lived. And there were very much fewer galleries. And it's hard to talk about this when you're older, because it always sounds like in the good old days. You know, but in some respects, they were the good old days in a strange way. There was a smaller community. There was a very rigorous exchange of ideas. The economy, the aspect of money was present, but it wasn't overwhelming. You could live in a city. You could have a big loft for $300 a month. Relatively a lot of money, but not like today. The people putting together programs feel to me now and then like they had much greater engagement, deeper interest and respect for the idea of the function of art and their function as a gallerist or a museum curator, something like that. I think this can be easily argued when you see about every 20 years young artists return with great interest to the 60s and the 70s. And there's something about that period of time, obviously, that is intriguing and very important to younger artists, some young artists. Many young artists today are only interested in the market. And that's fine, that's clear. And the structure around them is also primarily only interested in the market. But there are galleries in place here, Brussels, where I did a show. They're a very, very interesting group of people at the particular space in Brussels. And they're like old souls. You know, they still think and believe that the work is important, the experience of working with someone is important, and the audience is important in another way. The ambitions aren't there, but it's a new whole world, neoliberal world of capital, so everything has been sucked into that world. There's very little resistance, or there's very difficult for people to actually have a real resistance to it and survive. But there are those who do.
Yeah.
You do, they do, in Brussels and others, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that I have always sought out those situations. Never been particularly, I've also often never had the opportunity to work in larger constructs, but for me, I don't care whether it's a small space. What's important is what's going on in the program, what the exhibition is about, or what I may do there. I think this, the same set of conversations go play to curators, critics, art historians, as we've been speaking about with artists. I think, for example, October is obviously one of the great models of the last 40 years. It's a really interesting project. It's very narrow. Lots of people now complain about October being like a dinosaur, or, you know, and that very well may be. I don't think nothing lasts forever. Mm-hmm. And I think in some cases, they should, in fact, institutions or programs should say, it's over. Because the world has moved to another place. They've done their project. Mm-hmm. I'm close to one particular person in the October mm-hmm. group, and we've done quite a bit of work together. Many, not many, but actually a half dozen more, maybe a dozen essays or things like that. It's been an interesting and rich exchange. I think he's one of the more vital people of his generation. Primarily because I think he understood that as an art historian, you also have to maintain a position as a critic so that you could deal with contemporaneous problems, so that you don't get bogged down and too far into history. But I think that the academic world has gone the same way as the art world and everything else. It's been professionalized. Now it's a very ambitious young people who want to get the, you know, and for all kinds of reasons that may or may not be particularly interesting. Part of the reason why I think 40 years ago was a very different and interesting time was we didn't really have so much choice. It was kind of, this is the way it is, this is what we're going to do, these are the people who are around us, and we have to make something out of it. You know? Now it's like people come and go, and they join a gallery, and then they go to another gallery, they jump to another gallery. It's more like, to me, like sports. They start in a small gallery, and then they make their way to Zwerner or something, you know, and whatsoever, you know. And that was also very different than before. Yeah. So, it's a big world now, and it's just a different place. I don't find it terribly interesting, I must say. And again, I'm going to be accused of being old. Oh yeah, but you know, you're old. You don't know what's interesting now. You know. And maybe that's true. Yeah. Maybe that's true. You know. But I'm still alive, and so I have my opinions, right?
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.